We will now call to order the April 12th meeting of the City of Aiken Planning Commission. I'm delighted to see that we have a full house. It's wonderful to see a lot of citizens involved and engaged in our process. If some of you, for those of you who may not have been at one of our meetings before, let me review a little bit about our process. The first thing I'd like to ask is that out of respect to whoever is speaking, that we make sure our cell phones are on mute or turned off, if you would please do that. And I will actually check mine as well, because it would be very embarrassing, having said that, if mine went off. Our process is that we will call for an application. If you want, we'll ask those to speak in favor of it. If you will come to the podium and address the commission, then we will ask those who are opposed to the application to speak, and then anyone else who would like to rebut may certainly do so. If you have come forward to speak, if you would list your name and address for the record. And after you have spoken, if you would just wait a moment to see if there are any questions from the commissioners. Once that is done, then it will come to the commission for a vote. And understand that we are a recommending body to City Council. So there will be no final decision on your application today. We will merely make a recommendation to City Council, and you will need to attend that council meeting to hear the final disposition. All right. Having said that, our first order of business is the approval of the minutes from the March 15th work session and regular session. May I entertain a motion to do so?
Madam Chairman?
Yes.
So moved.
All right. May I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Abstentions due to absence.
Absolutely.
Thank Abstention you. Also for me. Today.
Yes. All right. We'll duly note that. All right. Our first application this morning is the True Testament Church of Jesus Christ is asking for city water service for a proposed church building on Reynolds Pond Road. Is there someone who would like to speak on behalf of this application?
My name's Calvin Staley. I live at 305 Rebel Road here out of the city of Aiken, South Carolina. I'm also the pastor of True Testament Church.
Sir, is there anything you would like us to know about your application that was not included here?
Well, no, ma'am. Everything is included in our application for you.
Okay. All right. Commission, any questions? Reverend Staley.
Pastor Staley, just one quick question. You saw the conditions of approval that are from the city planning department. Did you see those?
Yes, I did.
There are seven there. And you're okay with those?
Yes, sir.
Those requirements, including annexation as soon as the property becomes contiguous.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
All right, sir. Any other questions? All right, sir. Thank you. Is there anyone who would like to speak in opposition to this application? All right. Not hearing any. It's back to the commission for a motion.
Madam Chairman, with respect to application number 16-50003, a city services request for the True Testament Church of Jesus Christ, I move that we recommend this to City Council, including the seven recommendations, because it is in compliance with the comprehensive plan.
Second.
Is there a second?
Second.
All right. Any discussion? All right. All in favor? All right, sir. All right. We will be favorably recommending this to City Council, and you may want to contact the City Manager's office to see when it will be put on the agenda for which of the upcoming City Council meetings, and then you may want to be present in case they ask you some questions there. See, that was pretty painless, wasn't it? All right. Now, our second one is really two combined. Its application owner is Michael Calhoun, and it's the on Town Creek Road, and it is a proposed rezoning and plan. All right. Is there someone who would like to speak on behalf of this application? I think I saw Mr. Calhoun back there.
Hi, my name's Mike Calhoun. I actually live in Greenville now, but I commute each week. I had some conditions to sort of force that to happen, but really just wanted to give you an update. Not know that you've seen me here several times. Two of the buildings are under, the land's under construction, and lot E, which would be right next to the Town Creek Hair Salon, which mm-hmm. was purchased by a children's physical therapy group, and they will be building about a 6,400 square foot building. And then the adjacent building was purchased by John Tiffany, who's a pediatrician in town, and he'll be building his practice there. There's two other office buildings shown on that, which mm-hmm. is, mm-hmm. I showed those because in the event that we're successful in getting this rezoning to put these townhomes, and it is my intent for you to see me one more time so that I can go ahead and rezone those for office. So you sort of get a picture of the entire plan, at least as it is in my mind. But that's really it. And if you have any questions, I want to make myself available.
All right. Thank you. Yeah. Commissioners, any questions?
I just had a quick question. Mr. Calhoun, I know in the past on some of the related projects, you'd gone to great lengths to win the approval of the neighbors.
Uh-huh.
And I know you've been very proactive in getting their buy-in. Were you able to do the same for this particular
project? Well, I actually knocked on each door of the adjacent project. Not everybody answered the door. Actually, Mrs. Green is here tonight. She was, we worked out with her. She was the corner property, and we were able to sort of slice off about 0.7. I forget what it was, 7 cents.
It was a very small slice.
1,000 square foot lot. Yeah. Let me get that right. But it just sort of, because of the way the tree line, you can't even see her house with all the trees down. So that's what she wanted. But yeah, I did go out and I wanted people. I got a chance to meet with probably a half a dozen. And I've said that this is sort of what I'm doing. And I just, if a rumor starts, here's my number and I'll tell you exactly what I'm doing. So I didn't go to the extent of trying.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks.
Sure.
All right. Any other questions, commissioners?
What were the exceptions? Let me get to see those. What were the exceptions on this one?
The conditions?
The conditions, yes. Are you familiar with those, Mr. Calhoun?
Conditions.
Possible conditions listed by the planning department.
It was
1 through 5.
Oh, you have an unusual design standard in your. It looks like you're trying to force triplexes, and what you're asking for sort of makes you jump through a bunch of hoops. The reason I have such driveways is because that's what it took to meet the code. So I'm actually not asking for a variance. I actually met the code. It creates some loopy shared driveways and stuff. But trying to get to, I think the requirement says that you can only have 30% of the units that can have a driveway facing a primary street. I mean, you have to have the other ones on the side. It sort of creates, in my mind, a triplex. But it's just a funky way, that's all.
It's there.
But I don't think I'm asking for it.
Basically, they're going to be nine separate, three triplexes with three residences in each one.
Yes.
So there will be nine residences.
But the way to be flat is, he's doing this with retirement, so he wants to have a little rental community. So they will be built for rental, and probably eventually.
We can't hear.
You need to speak up a little bit, into the mic, if you can.
If you'll speak into the mic, face us.
So there'll be, could you just repeat what you said?
Well, yes, the intent is for these all to be built at one time, and the gentleman, Art Bremer, will actually be, will own them and rent them out as a rental. He wanted to create sort of a high-end rental community on the south end.
And just for clarification, since we did discuss this in the work session, one of the layouts that you have is corrected to show that the unit in the middle is not having an extra bedroom, it is having a garage. So all of the units will have garages. Is
I that think correct? That is the intent part for them. Yeah, for each of them to have a garage. I think what happened is the designer said, here's what you can do if you wanted one without
And that's fine. I just, since this is going to be part of our packet, I wanted to be very clear.
Sure.
All right. Any other questions?
Commissioner Hunter, did you get your question fully answered?
I think you understood my question about the conditions. There are some, under the current status of our zoning requirements, there are conditions.
There are five conditions.
There's five conditions. And we would,
I see.
They would be subject to those conditions under the current status of the zoning ordinance.
Okay, I'm sorry. Here we go.
You see those?
I do now.
Okay.
Yes, yeah, there was actually one of the other was you limited, it was a maximum of 18 feet for your driveway. I mean, and our plan showed 20 feet. And yeah, I'm willing to make it. I don't understand why you would have a limitation like that, but that's what the code says, and if we need to reduce it, we will. We would like to ask for a variance to something like that. We're trying to make these high-end and nice, and there's a lot of green space here. For development.
Okay. Any other questions? All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Is there anyone present who would like to speak in opposition to this application?
Can we ask a question?
Yes, if you'll come forward.
It's not an opposition, it's just a question. On this particular layout, if you could just explain what the numbers are, 157, 153, 149. There's way more than nine numbers there, so I was just curious what that was.
Oh, those are addresses.
Those are
the addresses that come from the GIS system.
But there's more than nine.
That's not the same development.
Yeah, that's not the same development. That's actually showing back behind it.
Yeah. So the ones on the top are the homes that are already there?
That's correct.
Yes, that's correct.
So that's not at all consistent then with this drawing?
That's correct. The GIS system is not up to date as far as what area is actually shown zoned. It lags behind, so it's actually showing a much larger area that's zoned. I think it was planned residential. RS6. So, yes, you're correct. There is a discrepancy. It's just unfortunately our GIS system is not up to date to what is current.
Which does make it a little confusing to understand what this is going to look like. We've had all our trees taken out over the last several days, so it'd be nice to understand exactly how this is going to work. So you're saying the homes that are already there, where are they on this? Are they up
Those,
here?
They're actually up top. They're not showing.
Okay.
Flat.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Is there anyone else who would like to speak on this matter? Yes, sir.
Dan Rogers, 139 Gibbon. The people on Gibbon haven't, don't really know what's going on with all this. This is our first. We haven't heard from the gentleman. But the question, the only question really, is how much of a buffer is there going to be between Gibbon area and where this is at? Is there going to be trees left along there? Or, I mean, they're pretty much taking out all the trees everywhere. But is there going to be some kind of buffer? Going to be open right from the back of the houses to the apartments?
There are actually two different issues going on there. The first development did have a very large detention area, so that's what you're seeing right now. Now, what for this portion of it, the rezoning, the townhomes, they will be required to have a buffer, but they have not submitted any sort of civil plans at this point. But that, yes, that is what you're seeing, and certainly you can reach out to the developer if you have other concerns about what he may be able to do as far as buffer.
Yeah,
this is already going in now.
Yeah, this is actually the first time the owners of that on that street knew that there's going to be apartments. It was professional offices is what we knew was going to come in. Mm-hmm. But that's fine. I mean, but you know. Thank you.
Well, there will be a requirement for buffer.
Well, how much? 5 foot?
10 feet? Well, actually, it would be 10 foot.
10 foot is
10 foot.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Is what's required by the zoning ordinance.
All right, is there anyone else who would like to speak to this application? All right, not hearing any, it'll be back to the commission for a motion.
Madam Chairman, I'd like to make a motion in reference to application 166006, the rezoning plan, and application 16-22001, the concept plan, that the Planning Commission recommend the City Council to accept the plan as submitted with the condition, those five conditions that were stated in the plan.
Second.
Any discussion? And I'll call for the vote. All in favor? All right. This will then be forwarded with a positive recommendation to City Council. And Mr. Calhoun, if you will contact the City Manager's office, he'll let you know when it's on the agenda. All right, our next item is an application for rezoning from RS-10 to GB for the Sumter Street location. Peter and Lynn Poulos are the owner applicants. Is there someone who would like to speak in favor? And he's walking up, thank you.
Totally.
Well, I'll keep talking to give you some time.
Hello, my name is Peter Poulos. I live at 1517 Audubon Drive Southeast in Aiken. I've been a resident here for about a year and a half, and it's a beautiful city. What I am attempting to do is rezone these three lots that I own on Sumter Street from residential back to general business. Prior to my purchasing the lots, they were zoned general business. The whole area is zoned general business. And it's my hope to do some development work there once this zoning takes place.
All right, commissioners, any questions for Mr. Poulos?
What's your general plan again, Mr. Poulos?
Well, I hope to put some retail stores in there that would serve the immediate and surrounding area. One of the things that I'm thinking about is a laundromat, for example, and whatever else would be something that would do well. I also plan to improve the basketball court that's in the center of the strip on Sumter between the Sumter going north and Sumter going south, and make that a much nicer place.
Any questions? All right, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
All right, is there anyone present who would like to speak in opposition to this application? Not hearing any, it's back to the commission for a motion.
Now, Madam Chairman, I would move that with respect to this application 16-60007, rezoning request from RS-10 as currently zoned to a GB, be approved. It's compatible with the general area. It's compatible with a comprehensive land use plan.
Second.
All right. Any discussion? All right, I'll call for the vote. All in favor? All right, sir, this will now be recommended favorably to City Council, and if you will check with the City Manager's office, they will let you know when it will be on the agenda for the next council meeting. All right, and our next application is for an annexation, a rezoning, and a concept plan for on Hounds Lake Drive. The owner applicant, Chip Goforth, Hounds Lake Seawall Golf Company Limited Liability Company. Is there anyone present who would like to speak on behalf of that?
Good evening. I'm Tilden Hildebrand with Hassan Hildebrand, 133 Greenville Street, Southwest. What I'd like to do is very quickly describe the development and go through the conditions that are listed in your very comprehensive report. The proposed development involves the construction of nine buildings with four units each. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. One of those buildings would front directly on Hounds Lake Drive, and the remaining eight buildings would front on a road that would connect to Hounds Lake Drive here and connect to the pool/tennis court parking lot here. Each of these buildings are very similar, and I have the developer and the builder here tonight, and I think he may want to expand a little bit on the specifics of the buildings, but these buildings would consist again of four units. The two outside units would have garages, some with single car garages, some with two car garages. The interior units would just simply have parking stalls in front of them. If you'd roll back down to the last slide that you had up. No, let's go back. Okay. You will see in the information provided to you that there is a current limitation on attached single family developments in the city, limiting the front entry garages to 30% of the units. On this concept plan, we have front entry garage is shown on actually 50% of the units, and we're hopeful that a waiver can be granted by City Council so that this number of front entry garages could be approved. I guess backing up a little bit too, this area here in the front of the site, although the plan says the opposite, this area that fronts on Hounds Lake Drive that contains the clubhouse is currently zoned general business. If you'll note in your packet, the comprehensive plan recommends that consideration be given to rezone that property to something less intensive. So hopefully we are in compliance with the comprehensive plan and related to that aspect. This area, pointer's going out. This area back here is in the county, and we're asking for annexation of this portion of the site primarily to contain our stormwater control, stormwater management facility, and leave the rest of that wooded. Related to the proposed conditions that the Planning Commission may impose, I'd like to run through those real quickly. I won't take a lot of time.
That's fine.
Again, 4.2.6 and 4.2.9 take in basically all the items that follow on this list, but item number two addresses the width of the driveways to particular units. There is a concern about the width of the driveway for these end units that have double garages. The ordinance currently requires that those driveways be no wider than 18 feet, and that's not a problem. We have those shown at 20, but they could be narrowed to 18. So that condition is not a problem. Again, item number three I discussed just a second ago about 30% of the units may have frontage or garages. Again, we're hopeful that City Council would be granted the right to waive that to increase that possibly to 50%. Item number four, that no unit shall be closer to 10 feet, closer than 10 feet to the exterior property line. And the areas that were pointed out in the report were the units adjacent to the pool. And actually, these units, the buildings themselves are 10 feet from the property line. There's a patio here that projects a little bit more than 5 feet from the property line. So actually, this building complies. However, this building up front is 5 feet from the property line, but we would certainly move that property line so that that condition would be met. So we wouldn't ask for a waiver on that. And then items five and six are just standard language to be added to the plan and execution of an agreement. So the only item that we're hopeful that we could get some relief from would be the number of front entry garages. I'd be glad to answer any questions you might have.
All right. Commissioners, any questions? Yes.
Yes, Mr. Hildebrandt, could you let us know the parties who were involved in this project, what their relationship is to Hounds Lake, if any, to Hounds Lake Country Club?
I might have to get the owner to address that. I am working for a developer. Mr. Charles Blackston and Chad Blackston are the developers. I'm not sure the relationship between them and the current owner. I think certainly the owner is hopeful that the development will proceed and he can sell the property to the developer. Now, I can ask the owner to come up and address that more specifically, certainly.
Okay, thank
you. That would be fine.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Would you want him to come up now or do
yes,
you want?
Yes, that would be fine.
My name is Daniel Sewell, and I live at 116 Scotch Pine Court, and I am one of the owners of Hounds Lake Country Club. Okay. I'd just like to, you know, our stance as owners is we're willing to listen to any options that might help us run our business, you know, and somebody might be willing to make an offer on some land that we own, and you know, one of our major challenges is the debt service that we have and the amount of cash that we have on hand, and it was brought to our attention that someone would like to make an offer on our land, and we're willing to listen in order to help the overall health of Hounds Lake Country Club.
Was there anywhere else on Hounds Lake Country Club property proper that this project would have been feasible?
Where it would be feasible?
Anywhere else other than this particular location on Hounds Lake property proper where this perhaps would have been feasible?
Yeah, I'm not a developer, so I can't answer some of these questions at all. I think there are some areas of the property that we own that there could be some future development. You know, but this one seemed like, not knowing for sure, this. Maybe it was tied in closer to the sewer. Maybe it was tapping into water. But this is the land that I think they're interested in.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Did that answer your question? All right. Thank you. Okay, Mr. Hildebrandt, is there anything further you'd like to share with us?
I don't have anything to add.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else who would like to speak on behalf of this application? Okay, is there anyone who would like to speak in? Oh, yes, sir. Please step forward. And if you'll state your name and address, please.
I'm Jerry Clements. I live at 107 Inwood Drive, which is on the west end of Hounds Lake, and I've been a Hounds Lake member for 26 years. I've seen it in its heyday, and I've seen it in its current condition. And I believe in the dedication and the commitment of Z-Wells to want to improve Hounds Lake back to as close to what it used to be, to the best of their ability. And this is one option, as Daniel explained. What I wanted to make a point of is that this provides a third option of housing at Hounds Lake. We have single-family homes, we have the villas, and this is now a third type of housing, which is smaller than the villas. And there are people that I've talked with that have said they're in the house, their husband or wife has passed on, they're single, they're beyond where they're golfing, or but they're still want to stay with Hounds Lake. The villas are older and they're still too big, and that a smaller unit of this type would possibly appeal to them as a way of staying with Hounds Lake. It also would appeal to young couples, their first residents, that are maybe active in golf and tennis and swimming, and would want a small facility that they could afford and start out with. So I'm just saying it's another option for Hounds Lake neighborhood, in addition to helping out the Hounds Lake overall.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who would like to speak on behalf of the application? All right, is there anyone who would like to speak in opposition to the application? Okay, you'll step forward.
I'm Helen Randall, 22 Cherry Hills Drive. We've lived in Hounds Lake since 1978 and built two houses. We chose Hounds Lake because it had restrictions and because it was a golf course community with associated amenities. The restrictions for most lots are 2,000 square feet heated. Our current house has about 3,600 square feet, and our lot is 0.53 acres. I looked today, and most of my neighbors have 0.53 acres. They have a similar size house. I don't feel like... and these houses, these townhouses that they're proposing go from 1092 square feet to 1750 square feet, and they're going to have 6.65 dwelling units per acre. I just don't think that's in keeping with the rest of the neighborhood. I think the location on the tennis courts is horrible, right there in the middle of the neighborhood. I wouldn't have a problem if they moved it to the edge, and I don't like the style of these townhomes. To me, those ones on Town Creek Road are much more upscale looking. These look like a bunch of single wides stuck together. I also don't like on the zoning regulations where it says a garage cannot stick out in front of the front plan of the house. Most houses now actually have the garage stick out. There's no variation in the style of these, and I think that I know that there's a market for master bedrooms on the first floor. I think they do need that, but I think they could have some variation with have some second floors with a second bedroom or a third bedroom or a bonus room or a loft or something to give some variation in the height. And I think I like the way that the I think it's called Hounds Lake Village, those condominiums behind Food Line. I think they look nice. I think the bungalow village houses, that's kind of a bungalow craftsman style. Those things are more in keeping with what people are building right now than these no character houses that are proposed. I feel like if they wanted to put those right by the bypass or somewhere else, they're going to have retaining walls, and also they show a solid wood fence. Houses on the golf course were not allowed to have fences unless they had swimming pools. Then they had a wrought iron see-through fence. This is not at all in keeping with anything else in the neighborhood. I appreciate the Sewell's need to make money, but I don't feel like this location or this look is appropriate.
All right, thank you. Any questions?
I would.
Just a moment. Feel.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Is your primary objection to the location, or is it to the design?
Both.
Both are equally important to you.
Important to me.
Okay.
I just don't feel that it's the right design and the location right there on Hounds Lake Drive, right there on top of the tennis courts. My next door neighbor plays tennis in a league. She's not going to, if they don't have all the courts, that kills their league. They're talking about dropping their membership because they're so disgusted with this. I realize that there are not that many tennis members right now, but it's still an amenity. The people who built, bought their houses and built close by expected the tennis courts and the golf course, and they're taking away one of the amenities. And the style is just horrible. And if they have a design review board for the whatever they decide to build, I'd volunteer to be on it. I'm a residential designer, and I just think this is awful.
All right. Thank you. Is there anyone else who would like to speak in opposition? Yes, sir.
Richard Arkin. I live on 21 Oakland Hill Street. I'm not in opposition. I have a question for this council to consider. If we could put the map back up, please. Look at the detention pond and you look at the narrative. The narrative states for drainage that it's going to be managed per the city of Aiken and DHEC's requirements. And it's going to discharge from the site will be onto the golf course drainage system. And when you look at this, the discharge is going to go across Azalea 7 because of the way the topography is, which then with gravity prevailing is going to take it to Azalea number 6. And there's a small unimproved strip that then runs to the north to the actual Hounds Lake. And that's county land, and it's, and I want to stress the word, it's unimproved. It can barely handle the current runoff. This design, because we're going to be taking ground away, is going to create more runoff into this detention pond, but eventually it's going to either overflow or go from there. And I don't believe due consideration has been given to the discharge event as it works its way to the lake. And having been flooded out 3 times in the 12 years we've lived there because of rain, I'm very concerned that this will magnify or amplify the runoff coming into there. And when you look at the storm drainage, the systems are basically 30 to 36 inch lines, and then it comes into a very small retention pond that the city now periodically comes and cleans out. But there's only one impediment in the flow of water getting to the lake, and it's not going to, I don't believe it's going to be able to handle under the current system the additional runoff that we're going to experience.
All right, sir, if you'll wait. Commissioners, any questions?
Sir, when you say flooded out, could you expand on that? Was your actual, your property, your home, both?
We've had our property flooded with damage, and as a matter of fact, the city's insurance company has compensated us to replace the items that were damaged on the side of the house.
What type of rain events were they when you were flooded?
What
type of rain events were they when you were flooded? You know, 3-4 inches in a day, something like that.
It's not an unusual rain. I would say if you take the rain that we've had over the last couple of storms where it really piled in, the current mini dam that's been built with stone slows the water flow down just before my neighbors, the Shelleys, have a driveway that's got a large conduit under it. It slows it down there, but also when the retention pond floods, there are 3 electrical substations right there. And you can look at the water damage that's happened to the platforms. Electric company is getting ready to do some changes, and I was just pointing out to them, there's all kinds of runoff damage that's taken place there. but it's not a 10-inch rain. It's a heavy rain. I don't know what that means from a civil engineering perspective, but with the unimproved drainage area, and it's fed principally from the streets of Hounds Lake, which are a city responsibility, coming in, and there's a lake upstream of this, Azaleas 6 and 5, that also feeds into the system, and Hounds Lake Drive and Cherry Hills Drive feeds into that area. So I think it's just an area that, as this is written in this narrative, I don't believe it serves well for saying how we're going to manage the stormwater runoff.
All right, any other questions? Thank you very much. Is there anyone else who would like to speak in opposition? The gentleman is walking down. Then I'll come back to you. Good evening.
Marshall, 111 Englewood Road, Aiken, South Carolina, in Hounds Lake. Several issues. The lady that was before me addressed some of them. The look and feel of the proposed development just flat out does not fit in that environment right on Hounds Lake Drive. It just doesn't. That's just a personal aesthetic thing or whatever. I'm also concerned about the additional traffic on Hounds Lake Drive, which is sometimes used as cut-throughs by various people. The city put in a bunch of speed bumps down by the Gulf to minimize that or at least slow it down. But what I'm most concerned about, regardless of the diagram, I have no idea how many tennis courts will be left. It'll either be one or two or zero. Many of us did come to Hounds Lake. We were made to feel welcome when we moved in here as part of the tennis program. The tennis program is gone. Well, will be if this is approved. Notwithstanding that, now, I come from an operations and maintenance background. I understand what deferred maintenance has done. That's part of the issue that the Seawells are having to deal with right now to bring the club back up, and I appreciate what they're trying to do. I just don't think this is the way to do it. That's all.
All right, sir. Any questions, commissioners?
Mr. Marshall, if I may.
Please.
You were talking about tennis. Do you and your neighbors use the courts regularly?
Yes.
Okay, I'm just trying to get
not all of the neighbors. There's a smaller group, and quite frankly, a few months ago, a number of the people that were much more active in tennis over there went over to Woodside because we lost our pro. Right. We now have a new pro. The man is superb. It was a great hire. He's good. But he can't rebuild anything if all he's thinking now is, I have nothing left. My wife is on the courts 3 to 4 times a week. I've been part of USTA South Carolina for a number of years. So I know what we have here, and we appreciate what the city's done to build over at Odell, other places, but we would have nothing left there. Anything else?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Sewell, would you please respond to the question about the remaining tennis courts first? Excuse us 1 second.
I have a question for two tennis courts.
All right, and that is a firm commitment that there will be two?
That's what we understand the concept will be presented to us.
Do you have any plans for building more or somewhere else on the property?
No, ma'am. No plans.
Okay.
But just so we do understand the plan, it would go from 8 tennis courts to 2. The pro shop would be consumed, as would the tennis parking. Okay.
Thank you. I think this lady here was next. Sorry.
Good evening. My name is Francine Allsbrooks. My husband Clifton and I live at 817 Hounds Lake Drive. Although all of the folks who have spoken to you tonight are concerned, I don't think anyone will be affected more than my husband and I. If you don't mind, I'd like to approach the map.
Certainly.
This is where my house is, right here. We share the block with this green, the present tennis courts, clubhouse, and swimming pool. We are also concerned about the amount of traffic that will be on our street. We are also concerned about the look of these facilities. We don't believe that they are within keeping with our neighborhood. We don't plan to move. We've lived in this house since 1990. This is our home. This is where we raised our children. And we want to be proud of our neighborhood. I don't think I could be proud of our neighborhood if I had to look out my bedroom window every morning and look at this. So I'm very concerned about what is going to be my next door neighbor. No one will be closer to this facility than we are. So I'm not happy about the prospects of it at all.
Okay, any questions? All right, thank you. All right, I think you missed. You can do that.
I'm Linda Schulte. I live at 21 Inverness East. And I would like to also go to the map to show you how I would be impacted before talking. Question for the Planning Commission. How many of you actually walked the property?
You mean have we ever walked the property?
Recently, just to see what's there and
absolutely
and look at
oh,
it.
Oh, I know exactly what's there.
Yes, yeah, we all do.
You're across the fairway.
Right,
there's
yes.
a fairway there on the other side of Hounds.
I'm just
you're
the
across
last,
that fairway.
The last house on Azalea 9. Just before the woods, so yeah.
Right on the green, right near the green.
As I'm looking at the Hounds Lake comprehensive plan, this definitely does not fit in with what the city fathers had in mind for us. So that's number one, my objection. And I know that's something that the city has to follow. They go for low or medium density, but not high density. Also, this development does not fall in line with the zoning ordinance for city for land in the city being rezoned to planned residential, in that it's supposed to relate appropriately to surrounding development in site and architectural design, dwelling unit density, and the types of buffers, walls, and fences. So, in my opinion, this doesn't conform to that either. Now, I have a couple of questions. How many units are going to be 1,092 square feet, which is the smallest unit?
Let's see.
Can anybody answer that?
Yes, we can find it and add it right up. Thinking of the other one. You know, offhand.
specific.
Will Mr. Hildebrand be able to answer that?
He might be able to.
All right, Mr. Hildebrand, would you step forward and answer that question? And please, may we all just let one person speak at a time?
Blackstone Development, there's one per building.
Okay. So there will be nine of them.
Thank you. And I was wondering about the makeup of the Hounds Lake Drive buildings, if they were going to have garages or not. It was hard for me to see on the reduced plan.
Two single.
Also, does the builder have a timeline on the building plan, on whether it's going to take 1 year, 5 years, and are you going to do it in sections, or what's the plan? Okay.
Okay, all right, Ms. Schulte's speaking now. Let's listen to her.
And the only other thing is, I went and checked with their townhomes that are of similar design in North Augusta, Whatley Place. Those units are selling for approximately $115,000, according to what I saw. And my fear is that this is going to appeal to people buying townhomes for rental purposes, and we're going to have a lot of renters in Hounds Lake, in a high density area, making traffic noise and things that we're not used to in our quiet neighborhood.
I just want to mention that an average price in Whatley Place is between $145,000 and $210,000.
Okay. Would you please repeat that in the microphone, please, for the record?
Sales price in Whatley Place is between $145,000 and $210,000.
And I'm just curious, of the Hounds Lake residents and the people that are here tonight, how many of you are for this and how many?
Ms. Schulte, you are to address the commission, please, not the audience.
I'm sorry. And I'm just wondering how many people in this room are for this concept plan and how many are against.
We'll certainly be able to know that if they care to come up and speak.
Okay.
But we
All
have
right.
to follow our process. Sorry.
Thank you very much. Appreciate
you.
It.
Let me clarify one thing, Ms. Schulte. Let me clarify one thing for you. The current zoning of this property, it was a bit of a shock to me. It's probably going to be a shock to you. It's GB. That's general business. General business is wide open. It's got nothing to do with it. It can be very dense. It's a GB zoning currently. The part that's in the city. There's a small portion that's in the county, which is county zoning or urban development or something like that. Very
yes, you do.
Relaxed kind of county zoning. But the GB section, so technically what they're asking to do is more restrictive than what is the current zoning. You with me?
Yes. Thank you. So, all right, is there anyone else who would like to speak? You may come forward.
Loretta Book, 67 Troon, Aiken. I'm a tennis player, and I know there are about seven or eight other tennis women here, and I was hoping they would get up and speak instead of me. But we are not opposed to this. We're opposed to the look of it. We're opposed to the location of it. We love Daniel and Jackie. We want them to make it work. We're only asking that if they do indeed lose the tennis courts, that we're asking the developer to take a consideration that he might put tennis courts someplace else prior to him even digging up any ground, that there could be a proposal that tennis courts could be built maybe someplace else. If we have two courts that they're saving, maybe he can do four courts in a different area, and there are places on Azalea that he could
I mean, that could be proposed, and we're asking that maybe that could be introduced to the developer prior to an acceptance of any proposals. So we want it to work in some way.
All right, thank you. And just so you're aware of the process, it is possible for the commission to, in their motion, add any condition that's appropriate.
Okay, great.
Can I ask a quick question?
Yes, please.
Thank you for the information on the golf. Do you mind if I ask you if you are in favor of this style of home?
No, I do not like them at all.
Okay.
Especially, I feel badly. I know people that live, because I play golf also, I know people that live across the fairway. I can't imagine looking at the wooden fences. That's just, I taught art for 31 years, and I just, they look like, to me, and I spoke to an architect, I'm an interior designer, but they look like modular homes put together. I think they could be neater, and I think the fence could be definitely improved. Okay?
Thanks.
Is there anyone else who would like to speak in opposition?
Is this the developer?
Pardon? Yes.
Can I just ask you a question about the fence?
There is no plan to have any stockade fences on the golf course.
Right.
They would be the ornamental iron type fence to not limit the view from the house or from the golf course.
So in your concept plan, this is just a conceptual style?
There's one shown without a fence that would be the example to have the ornamental fence.
So we can just sort of disregard this picture on the last as...
That is an example that would not be facing the golf course. For example, facing the pool.
Or the tennis court, or the existing...
The homeowners may not want to be looking at the pool. The pool people may not want the homeowners looking at them. So the golf course units only.
Do you know the concept of those neighbor-friendly fences where they have the alternating...
That's what type of fence this is. Okay. Shadow box.
Yeah, shadow box fence. Which I think might be more agreeable to the... So...
Everything doesn't translate in an artistic drawing.
I agree. So as far as the houses go, since there's been so much... from what I heard, it was that the people were... I understand that townhomes can only, and connected homes can only have so much of a look to them. But I did hear some objection to the materials being used, like the shakes and the peaks. Is there any?
We plan to use a variety of materials. We currently built these with stone, stucco, brick, fiber cement siding.
Are the individual houses going to look all the same? Are they going to have some differences?
There will be no facade that touches each other that would be the same. For example, you wouldn't have a brick beside a brick, so it would be broken up as far as the front facade of the units, as you can see on the front.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. All I needed to know. Thank you.
Just, Madam Chair.
Please.
Could you confirm the distance from the roadway of the unit that's actually on Hounds Lake Drive? How far off would that be?
I'll defer to Tilden on that.
That's why you're here.
While he's looking that up, do you know if they share a common firewall?
Yes.
Each one's got a firewall.
One has a two-hour firewall.
Roof all the way
down. Half liner.
Just obviously, it goes without saying, I think from what we've all heard tonight, that there is a fair amount of opposition among the people that are living in Hounds Lake now to this. This is a fairly drastic change. I think everybody will agree to that. I mean, this is a big change, and it's a fairly drastic change, I think. And I don't know the reasons behind it. I'm assuming from the comments from Mr. Sewell that there are financial considerations. You're the developer. This is the piece of property you wanted.
Yes, sir.
And I assume that you've analyzed other areas in Hounds Lake that is owned by the Seawells Corporation there that runs the club, and this is the place that you would like to have?
Yes, sir.
You think, as from a developer's viewpoint, this is the most logical and best business decision from your viewpoint?
Yes, sir.
I'm assuming that.
Madam Chairman? Oh, go ahead.
No, I think he's going to answer.
The building itself is approximately 40 feet from the edge of the pavement, and it's set back 25 feet from the right-of-way of Hounds Lake Drive.
Just at first blush, that seems awful close to the road.
That Mari, I believe, is a city standard setback.
For 25.
Any street in Aiken, a house could be built there.
Is that typical of the rest of Hounds Lake?
No.
I know the answer to the question.
I would say probably not.
Okay. Is that building integral to the project?
My understanding is yes. I'm not the developer. I just draw the plans, but my understanding is yes.
What, the front one by the tennis court?
Any other questions, Mr. Hillframe?
I would like to address the concern that the gentleman had a few minutes ago about drainage.
Yes.
That's sort of my forte. There's currently a metal pipe here, this dash, approximately where the dash line is, the city limit line, that drains much of the parking area, much of the clubhouse area, pool deck, et cetera. And it drains to an area, as the gentleman spoke, a low area through here. And it discharges overland part of the way, and then it connects back up and goes under the golf course and goes to this swale that he's talking about here. I would like to give him some assurance. Well, I will give him the assurance that the city has a detention ordinance that actually reduces the rate of runoff from a property. In other words, let's say that a site has a runoff rate in a 25-year storm of, you know, X CFS. The city's requirement is that that rate be reduced to the 2-year undeveloped rate. So actually, as far as flow rate goes, I think the flow through his property up through a 25-year storm will actually be reduced, the flow rate. So I would, I'd like to give him some assurance that the stormwater will be managed properly.
The restrictions on stormwater are actually tougher now, much tougher than when it was built.
The city of Aiken has the most restrictive stormwater ordinance that I've dealt with in the state of South Carolina, North Carolina, and Georgia.
It's pretty tough.
It's based on the Wise Hollow Drainage Basin and the problems that they've had over the years.
All right, any other questions?
Just one, if I could follow up on Commissioner Hunter's question, just real quick. There's some property, when you first start up Hounds Lake Drive, where the underpass is, the tunnel that goes through, and you're headed up towards Bungalow Village, there's been a sign up there for years about something that might be built there. And I'm just wondering, I'm not being flippant at all. I'm not being flippant. I'm just wondering if that perhaps was more suitable. That's away from the center of the development. It's away from the recreation center. It's on the bypass. Would that just not work?
Not on Bungalow.
We didn't look at that property with the Seawells. I'm not.
Okay, I was just wondering. It's just, it's clearly suitable for development because someone wanted to develop it.
Yeah, that was.
And I just didn't know if that was more. It seems a more appropriate location for something.
Is that
like this.
Mr. Covey's? Is that near the bypass?
Yeah,
is that,
between the Bungalow Village and then the bottom of the hill.
I'm not sure. There may be some floodplain there, but I'm not. I haven't reviewed that, so
okay.
I know there's significant drainage through there.
Okay. Again, I know every project's a little different. It's just
right. All
things being equal, it just seems like a more suitable location for something like this. Maybe it wasn't feasible, but I just wanted to bring that up.
Okay. I'd like to ask the developer a question. To follow up on one of the speakers, Is there a possibility that as part of the development process, you would consider adding additional tennis courts?
That'd be something we'd have to address with the Seawolves. We haven't had that discussion.
That would not be out of the realm of possibility, though.
I'm not going to say anything out of the realm of possibility.
Okay.
My concern with that is that, and I don't live in Hounslow, my concern with that is that that there was a covenant of some sort that when people agreed to build there that they were promised certain amenities. And of course, I'm sure it's up to the owners. The owners could close the pool next week if they wanted to. I understand that. But I just think that when you take out so much of the amenities, it would be encouraging, hopeful, promising, if the individuals who are concerned about that had some sort of indication that at some time in the future that perhaps additional tennis courts might be built. And I think that's something that maybe Mr. Sewell and you can address in the future. Maybe they can go down there in that piece of property on the bypass.
Well, the covenant's just for a lot of the homes on the golf course afford access to membership. It doesn't specify what will be a part of that country club membership. So I did look that up.
Oh.
All right. Is there anyone else who would like to speak on behalf or in opposition to this application? Yes.
I'm Mary Barber, and my husband and I live at 701 Cardinal Drive. My question to the developer is, number one, in one of his schematics of the four townhomes, the two in the middle, it didn't even show a driveway up to them. There was a grassy place, like you had to park somewhere and walk. So are there going to be people parking on the street where it is? If you could show.
I think he said the parking's going to be in front of them, right in front of them.
Like you can't even drive to them. There's grass.
Well, that's just a draw. It's just a conceptual drawing. I'm assuming you're talking about parking right in front of them. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. I mean, because it just looks like you're going to park on the street and walk up to them.
No, they'll be. Yeah.
Off the street. Okay. And then my other question is, which tennis court is staying?
Looks like the two upper courts, if I.
The two. So it's the one and two. Not three,
closest
not the
clay
court,
clubhouse.
Three and four.
Scroll it up. Yeah.
One more.
So that's one and two. And who is going to own those tennis courts?
Same people that own them now.
They will still continue to belong to the country club.
That property is not being sold of those two courts. And why do they even choose to keep two?
That would be a question for Mr. Sewell.
I mean, what are you going to do with two courts? Is that going to be your selling point? I mean,
we would want to totally eliminate it. And I would just like to say also, part of some of our business.
There are a lot of business considerations that we go through as owners. Our tennis courts are old. Our tennis courts are not in good condition. If you go by and drive through, they don't look good from the road right now. Some may even say that it's a safety issue. We have trees all over our property, and from time to time, and I don't know if this pertains to the Planning Commission or not, but I'd at least like to state it. Occasionally, we'll be notified that we have hangers, and hangers will be limbs, and we have hundreds and hundreds, maybe 1,000 hangers. But when it's brought to our attention, from a liability standpoint, it escalates our liability. And that concerns us. Not long ago, we had a golf match. We allowed the golf teams to come out, and there was a young man. He was walking. He was walking down the cart path playing golf, and he tripped and fell, and he broke his wrist, and he saw his bone. and he went into shock, and they called 911, and we had two public safety cars, and we had the ambulance come, and he was playing golf. Okay, accidents happen. Okay, right now, it's been brought to my attention multiple times that our tennis courts could be a safety hazard. As an owner, how willing are we to take on some of that added risk? It's just part of the consideration that we go to. You know, now people are gonna, you know, I could twist an ankle coming to talk to you tonight. Our tennis courts aren't good. The cost of resurfacing the courts is $180,000. Well, there's no money there. You know, so some of our decisions, and none of this is enjoyable for us. This is a business decision, okay? And this is a business decision to listen to somebody who might want to make an offer on our land. And a lot of people, I think, would be willing to listen to somebody who might want to make an offer. And that's our stance. And I think I was asked to come up for the why to have two courts. Well, we didn't want to, you know, we have 31 tennis members at our club right now. Okay. You know, that's not enough to sustain it. And these are friends of mine. And I think they care about me, and I know that I care about them. So none of this is easy on us either. But the overall health of the club is at the forefront of our decision.
And the two courts that remain are, just to wrap up her question, those are courts 1 and 2, is that correct?
So you're going to resurface those, or leave those as a liability?
I mean, I think at that time we'd have to look at, consider that.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I did not hear your answer. Are you going to resurface them if you go?
I couldn't make a commitment to say we're going to resurface that at this point.
Okay.
I think, you know, I appreciate your comments, Mr. Sewell. You're well thought of in the community, and I think even the people here tonight that obviously are upset about this still think highly of you and your father. And I'm sorry. I'm sad that it's come to this. I understand your position. It's a business decision. I don't know what the alternative would be. I mean, there's alternatives. Everybody needs to know that. And the Sewells are coming here with a proposal. If this proposal is rejected, they may come with another proposal, and it might not even be as good as this one to the members of the club. And so I understand that. But it's difficult when you have so many people who are opposed, and I appreciate your comments. You're well thought of.
Thank you. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. All right. Is there anyone else who would like to be heard on this matter? Not hearing any, it's back to the commission for a motion.
Madam Chairman, I'll make a motion on application 16-20008, the annex, and application 16-60008, the rezoning, and application 16-22002, the concept plan for the annexation, rezoning, and the conceptual plan request, that the Planning Commission suggest to City Council that we deny these applications based on the fact that it's clear that the community is not totally, you know, with this, that there's so many questions still out there and that kind of thing. So I would make the motion that we would deny these applications, and that recommendation would go to City Council.
Second.
Second. Any discussion?
Let me ask this. What about the annexation? I mean, I don't know. Maybe they don't want the annexation without either of the other two. But they're asking to annex the 0.9 acres into the city. Would you, Mr. Sewell, would you want the annexation without anything else?
That would probably be restrictive.
I mean, it would.
I don't want to pay more taxes.
Solves that
problem. I believe that answers the question.
Solves that issue.
All right, we have a second. Any other discussion? Any other comments?
Yes, I would just hope that in regards to what Commissioner Hunter said, that I think we're all very sensitive to the viability of Hounds Lake Country Club. I know I am personally. I want to see it thrive. I want to see it come back. When I hear people talk about its heyday, I have this big sentimental streak. I would have loved to have seen it. So I'm just hoping that there might be some other alternatives that the residents are more amenable to accepting, so everyone can win on this. I do have problems with a large country club being knocked down to two tennis courts and no supporting facilities and things like that. It just seems like a drastic change, but I just want it to be known for the record that I hope there are some other alternatives, and that speaking for myself, I'd like to see them. I'd like to see something else that will be a benefit to Hounds Lake and by extension to the residents and then any new residents that would come in. I really want to make that clear.
I would concur with that as well, Madam Chairman, and I hope that when they figure that out, that they do come back before us again so we can reconsider it again.
Yes, I would certainly hope that this would not be the end, but the beginning of additional dialogue and planning. Having said that, if there are no other comments, I will call for the vote. All in favor of the motion? Okay. Any opposed? All right. So the recommendation will be made to City Council to deny this application. And Mr. Sewell, if you'll contact the City Manager's office, they will let you know when it will be scheduled for review by City Council. Our final application for today, or item for today on the agenda, is the proposed amendment to the zoning ordinance to allow City Council waivers of attached city family residential project design standards. And since that is coming to us from us, I will ask if there's a motion for this amendment.
So moved.
Is there a second?
A second.
All right, we have a second.
At least we can discuss it now, Charles. Thank you very much.
And we can discuss it. All right. So anyone would like to make a comment? Any discussion?
Could I ask Councilman DeWar to perhaps come forward and clarify some things?
Yes.
Thanks, Dick. I just wondered if you could give us some background.
Well, I'm glad to see the assistant city manager come as well.
Excuse me one moment. Sure. Ladies and gentlemen, we appreciate that the issue that you're here for has ended, but we're still in session. Would you please carry your conversations outside? Thank you. All right, Mr. DeWar, I see you have punted the ball. May we close that door, perhaps, when you all are done? Thank you. Last man out. Close the door, please.
Stuart, it's good to see you, too.
Last lifeboat out.
Good to be here.
All right. Thank you. Okay.
Just want to restate just a little bit of background.
Sure.
Just to help us fully understand why this came before us.
Sure. I think one of the things that we've been doing here in the last 6 months is we've been looking not just at the zoning ordinance, but at a number of our ordinances between the city manager, business vitality manager, and other staff to try to find where there's some inconsistencies or efficiencies we could put in. And for example, here, we felt like removing that phrase that's listed in there, quote, accept the standards in this section, it would give us a little bit of consistency and also give council on a case-by-case basis some leeway to carefully evaluate and have some flexibility in deciding individual projects as they come. Certainly the advisory role of the Planning Commission will still be seriously considered. We looked at the history of this particular section of the zoning ordinance. I had staff pull when it was put into the zoning ordinance, the minutes. It was kind of unclear why it was put in. We just felt like there have been several instances here within the last 6 or so months where these issues have come up. And again, I think it would give council more flexibility. And I know they would carefully, as they've done in the past, you know, deliberate. It wouldn't, you know, and listen to the citizens still. But it does, by removing those words, grant flexibility by not exempting these sections. That was, I think, the genesis behind it.
Stuart, is there any particular one of these issues that would be something that could be amended to eliminate the actual memorandum that's presented?
You mean in terms of deleting a particular section of the paragraphs A through E versus deleting these words?
Correct.
I think the sense would be this would make it, with all the various paragraphs, this would give a little more flexibility. I think it was felt by staff, at least, that this is the best way to address this versus pinpointing particular sections. Mr. Raven.
By staff, you're talking about city management staff, not planning
staff. That's correct. We talked to the planning staff as well, yes.
No.
I would just say, quite honestly and quite embarrassingly, I voted to approve this. If I'm asked to approve flexibility and staff recommends it, I'm probably always going to do it. But it's one of those memos where I need a little more detail. I've got a lot more detail tonight, and I can assure you I will be meeting before we have a second reading on it. I'm not sure that I would agree with, I probably would rescind my vote to approve this, knowing what I know now. And I'll do some more homework before the next council meeting when this comes up. There's some issues that I've been appraised of that make it a little bit more complicated than what appears on the memo. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, you know, basically the concern is, as you know, when you, the city has they have complete control over the planned residential and planned commercial projects. Y'all look at that before they get into place and all. They have complete control over that. But these single family residential projects, what's going to happen? You're going to have lots and lots of exceptions requested, like the driveways tonight. That's going to come up continually, although the odd thing tonight was it seemed like both of them thought the requirement was higher than it actually is. Both of them thought it was a 20-foot driveway when it's only an 18-foot requirement. I would have thought it would have gone the other way, but that's what's going to happen. It's all street parking, the street layout, the roof line variation, the roof pitch and eaves. You know it's going to open Pandora's box on that. As long as y'all understand that.
and the key is that we understand the waivers we're being asked to approve. The political ball stops with us. We have to make the decisions, and we have to live with the decisions. I just want to make sure that we have all of the information to make the right decision, even though it may not be agreeable to everybody.
Right. I think the concern, too, is once an exception is made for person A, and then person B comes along, are you going to be willing to make that same exception for person B? You know, and then you've got person C. Well,
that's right. That's what's going
to
happen.
Well, you have to live with that. You have to live with that because you get projects that are slightly different and so forth. That if you,
but we're talking single family houses, and that's different than businesses, and
that's
it's
right.
Different than
yes,
planned
I understand.
Residential.
But there are projects that differ from one another, and we need to be able to make that decision and stand by it.
Right.
The concerns that I have and the issues that I would like council to really consider as part of their decision making is that while it was stated this was to simplify things for business, we are not talking about businesses here. These are residences. The thing that you know, that I would like to see, because it is the key role of the Planning Commission, is to be able to make recommendations to council that are consistent and fair. And that is a very difficult thing to do if the precedent is that we are managing by exception, you know. And I think that to be very consistent, and you know, if you look back at the history of one of the rationales for the Planning Commission, it is to be that consistent arbiter of ordinances, because council changes every couple of years, and the rules should not, though. It shouldn't necessarily be, and you have been on council long enough to have seen it change, that you know where it started and where it is today is a different mindset. I think you would agree with that.
Sure.
So I just have a concern that, you know, that we are not hampered in making appropriate and consistent recommendations.
Well, and I agree with that. And the challenge we have is to be fair as we can be to everyone. But we also need to recognize that times change, and sometimes with time changes, rules need to be reviewed. That seems to be the case here, and whether it's a good thing to look at or not, I'm not sure.
Well, I would be much more in favor of saying, let's review the ordinances in question and alter them, versus taking away, you know, the right to use an ordinance.
I understand what you're saying.
And I will tell you that the plan for this year, although we are not probably going to get to it because we are about a year behind on the comprehensive plan, as you know, but the next thing in place that Tommy Paradise and I had on the strategic thinking list for us was to review the ordinances. We didn't want to do that until we had finished the comprehensive plan, but you know, I think that's an appropriate thing for commission to look at. And I think that there are probably many ordinances that could be altered or tweaked to be more flexible and to be easier to apply. You know, that would have been the preferred plan, I think.
Hey, Kurt.
All right. Anything else that you want us to know, Stuart?
No, I think I've stated it and answered the question.
Yes, you have. Thank you. All right. We do have a motion and a second. We've had our discussion. Is there anything else that anyone would like to say before we call for the vote? All right, then I'll call for the vote. All in favor of the application, or the amendment as presented. Okay, thank you. All opposed. All right. Okay. Thank you very much. There being no further business before us, Planning Commission meeting is ended.